Ace of Shun, what is going on? Let's talk about AI art being used in RPGs. I refuse to say TT. TT, when you say TTRPG, what you're basically saying, total trash, and you're already apologizing for it. Just say RPG, people. TT, drop the TT. That's 40 years of baggage right there. Just drop it. Anyway.
This video is about how to get all your players on board with the same similar images, seeing the similar things in their minds, giving your campaign or your adventure sort of a solid feel, a uniform.
That's fine. You don't want to be... Okay. When you're showing pictures... I call them artifacts. When you show artifacts to the players, what are you doing it for? If you've already narrated the place to death, don't show them pictures. If you don't plan to narrate a whole lot of stuff, show them the picture first. Say, this is where you guys are approaching this place. Show them the picture and then describe what happens in these places. Maybe, you know, if it's general stuff. You know, like, it's got a population of, you know, 1,200, or a population of zero, or it looks decayed or something, you know, but don't be saying stuff like, you know, you don't have to describe, like, the rot, the decay, the corruption, the pollution, and then you show them this. And then you say, oh, by the way, this is what it looks like. And then you show them a picture that just doesn't match what everyone's memory is. Because all the players are going to have their own, you know, no matter how well you describe things, each player is going to have a different view of what it looks like. So, like, don't mix and match narration with images. Like, a picture is 1,000 words, right? If you've already said 1,000 words, don't show them the picture.
Feel to it. So the artwork I used, I know this is going to be controversial, I used AI to generate this art.
Oh,
now,
my goodness.
I am an artist. I love AI. I think it's
great. Right, years ago, I would think, oh, this AI stuff, it's going to replace me. It's going to replace everybody. This is like in the 80s when people that were building cars were thinking, oh my God, these robots are going to replace me. Or in the 90s when computers were showing up, you know, computers were replacing cashiers in the 90s, and cashiers, bank tellers, those kinds of people, they were worried, oh, I'm gonna be replaced by a computer. Well, if you didn't retire and get out of there soon enough, what happened was you ended up being the person retrained to operate the robot, operate the computer, fix the computer, install the computers. Yeah, it sucks to be someone working for NCR. NCR does all the scan and go machines at Walmart. You know, that guy, he's just on constant battle stations alert because there's always a broken machine somewhere. Somewhere in his district, in his region, driving 100, 200 miles a day in his own vehicle. You know, doing Swaptronics to get cashiers to work. In retail stores. Then the AI comes along, right? It was a few years ago. Oh, instant replacement of Michelangelo. Raphael and Da Vinci. Oh my God. The Renaissance has just been replaced by one single app. That's nice. So, but in theory, people who couldn't draw in the past, if they can afford the AI, you know, they might not afford, no one can afford their favorite comic book artist to draw their comic for. But if they can afford the AI, that's the key. If they have the computer to do it and they have the license, You know, it's not cheap. If they can afford that, they can do the art themselves. They can do their own art in the style they want. And I guess one can say, you know, guys like John Byrne can be replaced. I don't know if John Byrne draws anymore. I know he kept drawing for himself when he left Marvel. He was drawing for himself. Like the X-Men the X-Men universe, as it were, has continued on. He's got pencils after pencil drawing up full on pages, you know, on the big hard, you know, cardstock paper that the artist would draw on. He's got cards of those things. Filing cabinets full of them. Pencil drawings waiting to be inked by somebody and colored and lettered. You know, what the X-Men were doing, what Man of Steel was doing, just on his own, you know. Anyway, one day they'll do an omnibus of his pencil drawings, seeing what's going on with, what's happening with the, I don't know if Jean Grey's in any of his stuff, but, you know, I'd like to know what Cyclops, Colossus, Wolverine, Magneto, Nightcrawler, Shadowcat, Rogue. Was Beast with them? Oh, I can't remember. Yeah, Beast was on and off with them. Anyway, Rook. There's Rook and Bishop, the White Queen, the Black Queen, which was Jean Grey for a while. Them's were the days. I thought to myself, I'm going to draw comics. It looks easy enough. I can do storyboards. But if you don't draw every day, you're not going to get good at it. That's just the way it is. If you don't play the piano every day, you don't get good at it. If you don't play the guitar every day, you don't get good at it. One could say if you play D&D every day, you don't get good at it. But the art in the last 3 months... Just say what you wanted to do. Just describe only the good things about Leon's mother, you know, and out pops an AI. And if you have the money for it, a movie, animated film. Not just one frame, but several. Using photo references of someone you know. Voila, they're now acting in a film. Give the AI that person's voice. Voila, they're acting and saying things in the movie, and that they had no participation whatsoever in it. Things are amazing now. But I don't know if the artists would get replaced so much as producers, writers, script writers, editors. They can do some of the stuff themselves now instead of hiring a, you know, graphic artist department. Instead of doing that, they can just do it themselves if they have the time. That's the thing. How many hours are in a day? A one-man team, can they do it all by themselves? In the old days, they would try doing it on the computer. It takes forever to do artwork on a computer, doing 3D modeling. It's so much faster now to have the computer, because now the computers can do 3D modeling instantly. And it doesn't have to be exact. It looks good enough. It looks good enough to pass as someone spent hours doing this image on a, and the, you know, 3D Studio Max or something, or Carrara, or not Carrara, but oh, what was it? Cinema 4D, Blender, those kinds of things, Modo. The but let's say you still have a graphic in-house. Let's say you still have an in-house graphic artist, something, something department. Guess what those artists are doing now? They're not doing Illustrator. They're not doing... what's the thing? They might still be doing Clip Studio. They might still be doing, you know, Photoshop. But if they want to get the stuff out cool looking and faster, obviously they're going to be using an AI. They just have to. So the artists aren't being replaced, they just have more tools to play with to do their art faster. Like, no one has time to wait for you to spend 8 hours drawing one picture. It's all cool and all, but yeah, this computer did like 10,000 images while you were slaving away on one little pet project of yours for 8 hours. And the art department's already got their samples to pick from and layout and pages and stuff. And then the AI's doing their page layout for them. So that helps the person who does the page layout. They're like, oh, what would the computer suggest? And the computer suggests doing it this way. And now Photoshop has AI stuff in it. Now Clip Studio, they shot themselves in the foot last year when they said they're not going to put AI in their software. They said that's going to put people out of business or something. Now they're wishing they didn't do that, because Photoshop did. Photoshop doesn't care. Photoshop's like, you know, Adobe looks at your rendered art from a computer. Oh, your fingers are messed up on your guy? Oh, we have a filter. We have an expensive-ass plug-in filter for that to fix, AI characters that have missing fingers. Oh, their face looks jacked up, too? Oh, we have a filter for that that fixes that. So it's like, these companies that didn't go on the AI train, they're like the first wave, you know. They're, what is it called? They're the first responders, and then they do the triage work, right? Sifting through what needs to be done. And then you let the professionals like Adobe just come and just mop the place up. You know, Mr. Clean. Make everything look Mr. Clean again. Anyway, let's listen to this guy talk some more.
Great. I'll show you why in a minute. I have a lot of fun with it. But I am an artist. I do like to draw. I make dungeons. I make game stuff, as I'm sure most or a lot of you know. But the thing is AI, to me, is a tool like Photoshop. So I know a lot of people have some issues with copyright and stuff like that, and I think that that's warranted. Copying other people's art is not cool, and I do think that there's a problem there. So, but, you know, I've been to art school. I understand some things about art, and so what I've done...
Yeah, the new generation of AI isn't copying the artwork anymore. I mean, that was just a trial. A test run. There's an uncanny valley, especially in the 90s, early 90s, there was using computers to do actors' faces and stuff. People thought, oh no, this could replace actors. Actors are going to get replaced by 3D models. Maybe. I mean, in some of the X-Men movies, they de-age actors to make them look younger with computers. Some of it's fractal-generated stuff on the fly. Some of it is just taking old photos of an actor's face and then just blending them over their existing old face to make them look young. So they find photo references from other movies they were in when they were younger and just use those. The AI figures out, oh, okay, this is what their face looked like. Oh, okay, I'll just compare and contrast what their face looks like now and change it. Make it so they look the way they did in this picture instead of how they look now. So the actor's not being replaced so much, or they do replace the actor. Like, they just have a stand-in and then put the actor's face on their body. I mean, they used to have doubles. I mean, movies still have doubles for actions and things, right? Stunts and things, stunt doubles. They're replacing the actor, right? But the stunt doubles, what they do, they see on the board, they're getting replaced, right? movie studios are not going to hire stunt doubles. They know they're being replaced. So what the stunt doubles do is they learn how to use the programs, the computers. And they go into the CG stuff and they choreograph the stunts in CG. CG land. So it looks legit. They train actors to wear the suits with little balls on the thing, and that person becomes the skeleton that they use to put anyone's body over in the computer. So the stunt doubles, they learn how to do all that kind of stuff. Then they learn how to do the green rooms and the blue rooms and the brown rooms. Dune uses brown instead of green rooms, which is a good idea. And then everyone's not so much getting replaced, but just they're getting trained to do the other stuff if they want to stay in the business. Most people I know retire. They've done enough. They see the writing on the wall. They're going to get replaced. They retire. You know, some of them stick around. They want to work until they die, and they stay in Hollywood and they do all the things. They're in their 70s. They did the matte paintings when they were younger, and now they got the AI doing the matte paintings for them. They're having a blast. But now we're at a point where the AI isn't copying anyone. It's more like spiritual successors to old artists, existing artists. Like Sid Mead. If Sid Mead was around today, I don't think he would be suing everyone left and right. That's my Blade Runner. That's my spinner you're using. It's variants. If you change anything, just 25%, it's now yours. Change Darth Vader's outfit just a smidgen, you might get sued. But change it 25%, it's yours. Everyone looks at it and goes, oh, that's just another Darth Vader. Well, technically it's 25% different from the original Darth Vader. That's how franchises work. That's why when a movie gets made and they call it a reboot, technically they're changing 25% of the movie so they don't have to pay anyone royalties from before movies, from older movies. You know what I mean? They start fresh again. Star Trek does this. Star Wars does this. People groan. The fans groan. What are you doing to my favorite movie? Well, we're changing it. We don't want to owe everyone and their brother royalties for this movie that we're basing this reboot on. So we're changing it 25%. Anyway, so that's what the AI does. There's probably a slide bar thing, slide button, slide thing. You know, change it 50%, change it 100%, change it 25%, change it 1%. There's probably a locked-in default setting in there, in the AI. So when you ask it to do a render of such and such, it looks kind of like that person. But it's not an exact copy.
Is I've only used one single dead artist that has been dead for quite a while, and that's Constable. He was an impressionist. Beautiful paintings. I'm a huge fan of Constable. He was an English painter, and so
I use Rockwell. I use John Harris, Sid Mead. Who else? Frazetta. Ron Cobb. John Dykstra. Was it Dykstra? No, Joe Johnson. I think his name was Joe Johnson. He drew the Death Star and the X-Wing fighters back in the 70s. You know, concept. I look up concept artists. But I use Rockwell or Sid Mead for the final renders. And I'll use John Harris as a final render. But I'll have, you know, I'll have John Harris do the oil on top of John Burns inks or John Burns pencils. I'll have Sid Mead's penciling, inking, and then I'll have the guy I just said earlier, what's his name? Rockwell. I'll have Norman Rockwell. I'll have Norman Rockwell come in and do the shading, the finished shading of the image on a Sid Mead drawing. So it's a cluster. The pictures look amazing. Now Frazetta, when I was a kid, it was Boris or Frazetta. You liked one or the other. Now Boris just painted his wife over and 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 over. It's the same girl in every single one of his pictures. That's his wife. And so it's the 70s. That's what she looked like in the 70s. If you want to know what his wife looked like in the 70s, it looked like that. Frazetta, he drew all kinds of different women, shapes and sizes and body types. And so some people like the continuity, I suppose, that Boris had, especially if he bought his calendars in the 70s. Some people like the rough and tumble Frazetta, because every one of his characters is in motion. If you look at a Frazetta picture painting, the guy or girl in the picture or the monster, whatever it is, they're in motion. They're not standing still. But if you look at a Boris picture, a Boris picture is what poser artists copy from, where the girl's standing there with her sword. You know, or the guy's got his shield and he's got a sword. They're posing. They look like they're fucking posing. They're not in motion. They're just standing like a statue. Stand still while I paint you. Okay. That's a Boris painting. Frazetta, I don't know what he did. He's taking pictures of people jumping from buildings and stuff, and he paints them in those poses. That's his pictures are in motion. World of difference. But talking to nerds in the 70s, they never got that. You're arguing about artists that you only have seen basically on the cover of mass marketed books at B. Dalton. All the fantasy books had Boris covers or Frazetta covers, and you'd look and you would judge the book by the cover as normal. And you'd always put the Boris book back and you'd keep the Frazetta book. You didn't know what the story was about, but it just had better art on the cover. Now with AI, you're only limited pretty much by the algorithm of the AI and how good you are at prompting the computer. You have to type keywords. There's keywords you have to put in the prompt that the computer understands. So you get the exact... You even have to tell it stuff like what angle you want the camera positioned at, where you want the light coming from, what kind of light, is the light colored, time of day, is it foggy, is there atmosphere, is there density to the atmosphere? And then how do you want it? Do you want photorealistic, hyperrealistic? You want oil painting style, watercolor style? Chalk. What are those chalks called? I forget. Pastel? Is that the right name? You can do the Pantone nonsense. If you know the color exactly, you can use the Pantone scheme. You can do the three-point lighting. You got the front light, the side light, and you got the little back light, little highlight backlight, You can do that. The computer understands all those terms. Then you can do background. How do you want the background? Focused, in focus, not in focus, no backdrop. Do you want green screen behind the person? Is this artwork being used in video? All that nonsense the AI can do. Usually it would be like a team of three people in a graphics department doing that by hand. No, the AI does it instantly. During someone's lunch break, they're eating pizza, they're typing prompts, and Discord, the Midjourney Discord thing is just spitting out stuff. It's just a matter of getting it in the right size. Because it just renders a little thing like that. I just use pictures like this big, you know, fits like quarter page, half page images for letter size paper. But if you're trying to do a poster, you gotta upscale it, that's gonna cost you. Anyway.
I only use him. He's gone. There's no copyrights on his work, and I don't think he'll object to me using his style with AI. So that's what I've done. That's how I did this. And
yeah, I don't sell my stuff, so I'm not worried about someone coming back later. Oh, you use some art from somebody from 100 years ago. Pay up.
I think using living artists, yeah, I do think that that's problematic. I really do. If you're just going to use the art raw. But anyway, the reason I used AI is because I know...
Well, yeah. Yeah, you don't want to be going in just clipping artwork from your 40 years worth of Marvel on PDF. You don't want to be just clipping art from that and sticking it in your book. I think that's a violation. That's like a treaty violation right there. You're just asking for untold harmage coming at you.
Oh, not everybody's an artist, not everybody draws, but if you run a D&D game, having art is really wonderful to be able to show your players. And so this is a really easy way to get copy.
I wish showing artwork to D&D players would get them to roleplay. That would be amazing. No one's invented such artwork yet. It's fun to think about.
You write free art. Use a dead artist like Constable. You could use Turner. You could use all kinds. Like there's a plethora of artists, and AI seems to be really good at simulating dead artists as well. So you don't need to go and look for living artists.
Okay, here's a trivial thing. Girls in the 80s playing D&D. During their downtime, they were drawing. Girls draw. And I don't know if it's ElfQuest or what, but something gets women to draw their character. Because especially if you have like not so much ancient RPG, but something fresher. Preferably something that came in a box. It had decent artwork. And it looked like you could almost color the pictures that were in the book. It looked like a coloring book. Girls love coloring books. Anyway, so some car crashed outside, so everyone's like bzz, 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 talking about the crash still. The cars are long gone and people are still standing around the street corner talking about a crash. So the girls would draw their silhouettes of their characters for their character sheet. This was a thing back in the 80s. All character sheets back in the 80s had a little rectangle area near the top, blank. That's where you drew your character. And I don't know if that still exists today. I don't see hardly anyone on YouTube doing it anymore, but in the 80s it was a huge thing. And girls would always draw their character. Down to, the color of the fingernail, the color of the lipstick, the gown, the dress, the armor, everything. Too detailed. You know, this was an index. It was 3x5. The area on the character sheet was 3x5. So you had plenty of room to draw there. GURPS did it too. I could not draw people with spit, so that section of my character sheet was always blank. I was just a blank.
So you can look for older artists that are gone and you can use them. And so what you do, I use Stable Diffusion. I have it installed on my computer. So I use Stable Diffusion. And so I just put in my prompts and I put by Constable. And it's good enough. And I get these absolutely beautiful paintings.
Yeah. I used to say, rendered in the style of Sid Mead. And all you have to do is say by Sid Mead. That's all you have to do. The AI knows who Sid Mead is. You know, it's a multi-pass. The AI knows it's a multi-pass.
that are based on his artwork, but like I say, he's long gone. There's no copyrights on it anymore, and I don't think I'm hurting his feelings. If anything, he's probably really excited that somebody so far in the future loves his art so much that they're using it this way. I know as an artist, I would be ecstatic if somebody, you know, put in art by Stephen Joy in their thing, you know, 100 years after my death. It'd be amazing. So that's what I did here. So, without any further ado, I'm going to start. I'm just going to show you.
One thing was, I bought some of the Gnome Workshop videos that Sid Mead did. They're on DVD. He did like 5. I got 4 of them, I think. 3 or 4. I can't remember. Like, they were expensive at the time. Like $69 each. I thought this is weird. The guy, it's 2 hour long videos, right? And the guy's drawing with a ruler. he drew with a ruler. So I was like, I remember getting a ruler slapped out of my hand when I was using it in college. I think I was drawing myself and I was using a ruler and the teacher's like, do it by hand. Best thing he ever did. I can draw people perfect if I'm looking at a person. I can't do it from memory though. I remember this one time the teacher had us, they had an iguana. I don't know what the deal was. I can't remember who. No pets allowed in school, but anyway, someone brought an iguana and it sat very still on the table, and we all sat around the table and we drew the thing. The trick was, the teacher said, now draw, okay, big old, you know, newspaper, news, how they call it, it was pulp paper, a spool, it was a spool of newspaper, newsprint, it was a newsprint, that's what they call it, yeah, a spool of newsprint, looked like for wrapping fish almost, but real thin paper for just doodling on with charcoal or a pencil. And so each one of us got a little, you know, 22 by 17 size paper, something like that. And we were told to draw this iguana, but without looking at the drawing while we're drawing it. Like, oh, you know, challenge accepted. So I drew my entire iguana without looking at what I was drawing. I was looking only at the iguana. And I don't remember what it looked like. Because the teacher grabbed mine. And he says, he holds up the glass and he says, this is how it should look, people. I think he kept it. I never even saw the thing. Does this guy have this to show to future classes? I'm like, sure, I guess. He did that with a lot of my stuff. I would have liked to have got a Xerox or a mimeograph of it. A Ditto machine copy. I was looking at the other people's drawings and none of their stuff looked remotely like. Even if it was abstracted out, you still couldn't tell if it was an iguana. Mine apparently looked just like an iguana. But it looked like, I want to say it looked kind of abstract, but you could tell that it was an iguana. Like the lines were not meeting up everywhere. Because I wasn't able to look at my own drawing while I'm drawing it. And it was I drew the scales and everything. The eyeballs, the teeth, the stupid toenails. Yeah, the tail, everything. Did the whole. I finished mine at least. Maybe that's why he liked it. Maybe I was the only one who actually finished it before the end of class. And then he would always do that with. He would have us get ready to draw, and then at the last second he'd give us a twist. I was like, man, I'm getting all my stuff out, my case of stuff, slide rules. Compass, protractor. And he's like, get rid of that. No. We're going to be painting with light, not with paint. I'm like, huh? What now? What? We're going to use the tones and the values, but not the colors, just the value. What? The what? So he taught me how to draw chrome. I still remember how to draw chrome. Most amazing thing I ever learned in art school. When you look at it, you go, oh my God, that's chrome. You drew chrome? You drew a reflection, you drew a toaster that's chrome and it's reflecting another toaster next to it? So we did that in the art school. That was fun. I have those pictures. I made sure I kept those. Anyway.
Basically what I think is a great way to do an adventure using AI. Now, this AI can be a little bit tricky to use. You have to get used to the prompts. You'll need to read up on a little bit. There's lots of free AI art generators out there. I use Stable Diffusion. I just downloaded it, installed it on my computer.
Let's see. I've got Desgo, and I've got, where's the other one? Wombo. Here's Desgo. And then it's using, ooh, they got some new stuff here. Dream Shaper. Yeah, Stable Diffusion, all this stuff. Ooh, this is new. So you can get people looking like her now. Less anime. These are more anime looking. Epic Diffusion. Ooh, that looks real. This is what they use now on Twitter when they post a girl's face and they say, would you date her? And it's like, dude, why are you posting AI pictures every day on your Twitter? Absolutely. Absolute reality? What? What? I'm going to have to try these two. These look cool. These are for doing your NPC characters. If you're a referee or if you're a player, you want a character, do that. Yeah, I want to check this one out too. This one looks too real though. I don't like my characters to look like photos. I like them to look conceptualized, but not full-on realistic photo quality images. And then what was the other one I used? It was Wombo Art, something like that. Wombo Dream. This one here. Create. It's got all these styles. The premium ones you pay for, but the free ones, get off. The free ones are amazing. Like HDR is amazing. Comic is good. Let's see, which one? Retro Sci-Fi is good. I haven't seen Horror Cut. That's new. I've tried the old horror one. It's okay. I'll have to try this one. It's a dark... the rest of these aren't all that good. These are from 2 or 3 years ago. Isometric one's good if you're doing like a 3D video game kind of thing. The polygon one is good. These are all old. These are all ancient. No one uses these. That's why they're free still. Anyway.
I find it's absolutely wonderful. I love it. But there's all kinds of them. You can find lots of them online and they'll generate art for you. Some of them you have to pay for, some are free, some are finicky, some are less. So it's just a question of finding one that you like that you can
do landscapes. The AI is good at doing landscapes. Don't do close-ups of people. If you do children, they come out mutant looking. They're missing their hands and feet. The AI doesn't know how to do children's fingers. And, you know, infant size hands, you know, fingers that 2 or 3 year old kids or younger would have. The AI doesn't get that. It doesn't know how to do it. So they have stubs.
Can work with. Okay, so the first thing is I'm going to start my adventure, and I'm going to say my players that they're wandering down a road, and they come across a small town, and they see a small town. And this is the image I've got for a small town, which I think it's a beautiful image. Does it look like it fits into a modern game? I'm not so sure. I mean, lots of modern games use old art from old books, from dead art.
What's a modern game? I don't watch this guy's channel, so I don't know. He did a thing on Traveler a month ago. I don't remember what he said. So it's probably like my channel. Unmemorable. You see my video once and that's it. You're gone.
Artists. Nobody seems to object to that. This is an old dead artist, Constable, like I say. So,
okay, Stefan, is this going to be a drinking game where every time you say this is a dead artist, Constable, drink up, man. He's mentioned it like 6 times now.
I don't know what, I never thought of a name for this, but I just put in medieval town.
It's got a name. The AI gave you a name. Just read what it says here. It says it right here. Copyright. Blah, 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 blah. The AI, the AI that came out 4 weeks ago has English now. When it writes stuff, it writes it in English instead of made up language.
By Constable. And I ran it a few times and I just picked the best image. So So they break through, they're coming along a road and they're approaching what looks like a large town.
Yeah.
And this is what it looks like. There's no paved roads. The roads.
Yeah. You don't have to say, oh, by the way, I used AI generation for this video, for this picture I'm showing you. Don't do that to your players. Just show it to them. Let them look at it. Only the keen eye can detect that an AI did it. And you only spent 2 minutes doing this picture instead of 2 hours going on Google image search looking for something to print out. Unsplash, right? Yeah, here's Unsplash. I used this for a hot 5 days. I was going to say hot 5 seconds, but I used it for more than 5 seconds. It's a collection of photos people upload, and then you can use them for your adventures. And after 5 days, I realized, oh, there's only like this picture here. There's like 5 kinds of pictures that are like this, and that's it. There's no selection on this Upsplash. It's like, I want a picture of building. You do a prompt, like, not so much a prompt, but you're doing like a search. How do you get out of this? You do a search, right? Up at the top, you say, I want to search for modern day living room. Okay. Here's some modern day living rooms. And it starts looking like, I don't know, it's just, there's not enough oomph to it. I think the idea of this site here, what's this site called again? I already forgot. Unsplash. I think they want you to eventually buy the picture as a framed thing and have it sent to your house. That's their goal. So they try to have uploads of things that are frameable, for one, and look like something you would hang on the wall. Not something you would use as an artifact in one of your tabletop game sessions. Like, once in a while you get the eye stock thing, but. Anyway, by the way, these are all computer renders. None of these rooms exist. None of them are photographs. These are all CG renders. I do this all the time. It looks real. Oh, wow. 37,000 similar images. Okay. And you just do this. And after a while, it's like you realize you're staring at the same five artists. There's not many artists on this webpage, and they just, every day, they're just uploading, cranking out stuff. So it's like five styles of modern rooms. I mean, there are more than just five styles for modern living rooms. There has to be. But no. You know, if I upload modern living room, people will see it, and if they know me, they'll recognize, hey, that's a Shawner thing. That's Shawner's style of modern living room artwork. He's been uploading to this place. That's what this is like. It's like, you know, the person who made this picture probably made this picture. The person who made this picture probably did this picture. And the person who made this picture probably did this picture, you know. It's like, I want to see thousands of modern living room images, real or rendered on the computer, it don't matter. I want to see thousands of them, but I want each one to be done by a different architect, different graphic artist, different hobby person at home who does this on their computer. But no. Nope, this website has to, I don't know. They only got five artists? It doesn't make sense to me. Now, if I go to Pinterest, let's go to Pinterest. Can I spell right? Pinterest. Am I still logged in? Am I still a thing? Where's mine? Let's see. If I want locations, right? For Traveler, here we are. Boom. Boom, boom, boom. Each one of these pictures is done by some different person. Now, these are just PNG files, copy pasted 1,000 times on Pinterest. Because Pinterest is the human collector. Pinterest is a, instead of using an AI algorithm to sort out pictures into various categories, I don't know, until recently, maybe it doesn't do this anymore, but until recently, Pinterest hoped that the humans logged into their web would do the categorizing of the images that they're collecting and pinning on their boards. Each one of these pictures is a pin, like on a cork board kind of thing. So here's my Traveler locations cork board, and these are all my pinned photos that I found on the internet or on someone else's Pinterest. Some pictures might be from me in here, which would be rare. I try to get pictures from other people. I think I do have, let's see, if I need abandoned locations for Traveler, I've got these. Look at that. Here's everyone getting ready. All lined up, getting ready to fly on the atomic bomber. Getting out of their hellhole. They don't want to live here. Their radar thing doesn't work anymore. Technology's kind of at a dead end. No one wants to live in this building here. No one wants to live ever in this building or this one. They want out. They want out of dystopia. You know, Foundation. This is Foundation. This is Foundation. Here's Foundation. Foundation. You know, Isaac Asimov. You know, a concrete world, concrete town, city, whatever. City made of concrete. That's like, this is Foundation, where the plants take over. You know, people leave, and then the concrete city gets taken over by plants. You know, life after people. This is life after people. Like, who lived here? Who built this place? Who lived here? Who made this monolith thing? You know, what is this? What's going on here? What's this? Well, you know, flying trucks from the 40s? What's this? What's this all about? Anyway, so this is how I used to do it. I used to do it this way. If I needed hardware in Traveler, here's my hardware in Traveler. I like this. Batmobile silver. It's not black, it's silver. Those were the days. Anyway, so yeah. Typical Traveler stuff. 70s. I call it Art Nouveau 70s. You know, you got the shag carpeting, everything's orange. Egg, you got the egg chairs going on. Wall, was it wood paneling? Stereos, TVs built into the walls, that kind of thing. This kind of crap. These days are gone now. The AI has replaced all this. I don't use Pinterest. Since I started using AI, I don't use Pinterest anymore. Some of this stuff, you wonder, am I collecting a photo? Like this girl here with the light pen. Am I collecting a photo of her? Is that a real photo, or is that the AI doing that? That's where we're at now. We're at the part now where we can... It's hard to tell now. If you're looking at an old artist from the 70s, like here's a Ron Cobb drawing. Here's a Ron Cobb. Or if the AI just copied that style and made something similar to his drawing. Know what I mean? Some of these you look at and you go, an AI could have done this. Like an AI probably could have made this. It's hard to say. You know, 4 years ago, this would have been modeled by hand on a computer using polygons. But now, the AI can just do this now. The AI has access to all the art stations, all the CG society, all the deviant art that's out there. And it's already gone through that stuff. It went through that stuff a year ago, so it doesn't have to go through it again. It knows. And it learns from learning. The more it does, the more it needs, the more it knows it needs to learn. So it learns some more. And eventually, the AI just draws crap like these cars here. Without a second thought, it just draws it. It just does it. Oh, you want a dashboard from the early 60s? Boom. You want a floating car from the late 60s? Boom. You want a rocket car? You want a nuclear-powered jet car from the 50s? Boom, there it is. These are photoshopped, obviously. You take an existing car, and then you photoshop it to death. Like, here's an existing car. Someone photoshopped it and just gave it all headlights on the front and erased the wheels. Other than that, it's the same car it was parked on the sidewalk. Here's another one. You stretch the car, you erase the wheels. You know, no one does this anymore. No one uses Photoshop to make a car that floats. This guy, he, you know, take an old car from the 60s, erase the wheels. No one does that anymore. The AI, oh, here's my Sinclair. Yeah, this is my first computer for programming Traveler with. This looks like a scene from THX 1138. You know, the computers. Some sort of telephone. Telephone command center. Anyway, the AI. The point is, the AI can do this now. I need a computer that's from... I need a computer that's 70s style with the bubble CRT screen. Maybe positioned vertically instead of horizontally. Here you go. Here's one. Here are several. That's what I like about Midjourney. It gives you several to pick from. And then you pick one, and you say, well, I like this one, but give me some variations of this one. And then, here you go. Here's a Sid Mead bathroom. Looks real as heck. That's a drawing. I want to say this is Deckard's bathroom in his apartment. Anyway, the AI can do this now instantly. You don't have to search high and low for an artist that may have done one that someone may have copied onto Tumblr to post from. No. Just, where are we at now? Okay, we don't need this one, do we? Was it this one? There it is. I found you. Don't start over again.
Why did I get promoted? Because I'm awesome? And because I'm using Word.
But I just put in Medieval Town by Constable, and I ran it a few times, and I just picked the best image. So, let's...
How many times did he say Constable? Oh, I should have brought a drink.
Let's, So they break through. They're coming along a road, and they're approaching what looks like a large town. And this is what it looks like. There's no paved roads. The roads are dirt, and you can see the small houses. There's a church or a temple in the back.
Is it me, or did I just do what he's doing now, showing a picture and then describing what you see in the picture? Did I do that, or did I just say, hey, this is such and such? I show you a kitchen sink. I don't tell you, here's the kitchen sink. In the kitchen sink picture? I don't do that, do I? What else is he going to tell us about this picture?
Background. Now, I would mention to them that they can also see a castle up on a hill in the further distance. But instantly, my players have a good idea of what this town looks like. Right? And right. Everybody's got sort of a uniform image in their mind. And I don't know what.
Well, they have an image of the image they saw in their mind. If they can imagine, they just fill out from the sides and the top and bottom. They can do a pan around. They, from where they're standing, they can do a 360 if you say what's behind the characters. Without showing them the picture, they can probably imagine what's behind them.
Call this town, let's call it, Marytown. How about that? There's a lame name. All right, Marytown. Because it's happy, right? Constable does happy, bright colors. Love is clouds. So let's call it Marytown. I know it's lame. But anyway, I printed these out. You don't have to print them out. Stable Diffusion will do really good just images for you. And you can use that one, you know, that is with Discord. That's a...
You're not going to tell us what printer you used?
Good one too. You can, and if you want to try it out, you can do a free trial of it. And then if you really like it, you can pay for it. So like I say, it took me about an hour to generate these images, but I've had a bit of practice with it. So
an hour.
Anyway, so here they are. They're at Marytown. They see it. So they can ask me some questions. What's this? What's that? But I've decided, no, I'm going to give them a map of the town. So here's a map of the town. Now, if you can see, the AI doesn't really do that great a job. I mean, it hints at, it sort of...
Well, you got to give it a style. Give it a style. Tell it you want it to be surveyor map. I don't know what this is. This is just artsy-fartsy wallpaper you'd find inside of an Olive Garden. This is what this is. This isn't a functional map.
Sort of shows the buildings, but it doesn't like if it was a proper game.
This is just background noise you find in the dental office while you're waiting for the dentist. That's all this artwork is. I mean, it's fine. I wouldn't show this to the players though. They'll be looking at it going, oh, what is this? Where are we? Where do we need to be?
Game cartographer, the buildings and stuff would probably be a lot more distinct. However, there's lots of games that use art that's even harder to read than this. Lots of games do it. And
really? Show one. Show one. This is Cartoonville that you got here. Wrap it around a globe. Use it for a cartoon of Earth. Here's Earth in the Middle Ages. That's what you got here. That's what this is.
And so with a little bit of ingenuity and imagination, you can use this map, and then you can easily take this map and you can say, okay, I want a location in here. I'm going to...
Okay, where do you ink the city names so that you can read the city names? There's no room for city names or street names or where the mayor is. What? What is this? Where do the cows live? In just the green parts?
Use this as location one. So just with a marker, I'm just going to write it on there. There's location one. What's location one? It's a tavern. So when the players get in here, they start wandering around. They realize there's no roads or anything. There's just paths everywhere, which is very realistic for a medieval town. I like that. So they're just wandering through, and they run across somebody. And they ask, where is a good place to, you know, sleep for the night or hang out or meet people? And they tell them, oh, well, that would be the Blind Dragon. Right. So number one, I'm going to put number one.
How long does he do that for? Okay, not for long.
Blind Dragon. I'm just making this step up as I go along here. Anyway, so the Blind Dragon, right? So number one, make that the Blind Dragon. So what does the Blind Dragon look like? Well, you guys wander past a whole bunch of houses and small buildings. You see some shops and whatever sprinkled in between them. There doesn't seem to be a real downtown area, nothing like that. But you do see some Cartwrights and blacksmith and that kind of thing until you come to a rather large building. And you see that it's a tavern. You can hear music coming from it. You can smell food. You can hear happy noises. You see some people wandering around on the outside. Right? And you see a sign on it that says it's the Blind Dragon, which, by the way, you would never see in the Middle Ages. You would instead see a picture with a mug or something on it. But anyway. So this is the Blind Dragon Tavern. Now all of a sudden the players really have a good idea of what they're dealing with this town. What they might expect, right? So they decide, okay, well, we'll go in to the Blind Dragon. And what do we see inside the Blind Dragon? Well, you see a really crowded scene full of townspeople. There's a second layer and there's tables up there, and you see people eating.
See people's feet. They're not just hanging in the air, are they? Hopefully they're like back farther. And this is like some sort of a wall. It's hard to tell.
Eating up there. It's a very smoky environment. There's a lot of cooking going on somewhere.
See, this is where I would use a Norman Rockwell painting of a saloon or a bar. And it would look real. And it would look like a Norman Rockwell painting. Instead of this gibberdy-gush. Just muddied up artwork.
You see a large woman that seems to be in charge of it. And you see people talking. So again, this was a... It's just the inside of a tavern by constable. So I'm not, nobody's art's being stolen, nobody's name's being ruined, nobody's being hurt at all by this. And it looks great. It really looks good. You can see why I'm a fan of AI art. And I'm a fan of using art in a game. Because you show people this, and suddenly they really have an idea.
An idea? Okay, so they suddenly have an idea. That's great. I like that players have ideas. Now, how do you get that idea out of their head? I ask simply. Simply as a common man who likes to roleplay. How do players let others know what they're imagining?
They're not thinking about the bar downtown now. They're not thinking. You've taken them right out of the modern world and you've put them right into sort of a fantasy world. You know? And they get a really good idea. Now, for myself, I would give this lady a name. Maybe her name is Maven. Right? And I would...
Yeah, but, okay, let's say the players can't imaginate at all. And when you say tavern, they're like, what's a tavern? Then you show them this picture, they go, oh, okay. Now they're imagining that they're in the tavern. Okay, now what? Are you like poking and prodding the players? Because at the end of the day, the players are just there to roll dice, right? You're just there. They're just there to be your human die rollers. Because you're playing, as a GM, most of the time, you're playing a solo RPG. And you don't want to be by yourself while you play the game, right? So you have friends come over. And you give them dice and you tell them when they get to roll. It adds randomness to your RPG game that you're playing. They just sit there and I guess they have nothing else to do. And they just wait for you to ask them to roll dice. And they're more than happy to roll dice for you. They have no clue what they're doing in the game. They have no idea what your game's about. They're just happy to roll dice for you. So I don't know if they even need to be shown a picture, if that's the case. I mean, I guess you could show the players, you know, your friends who show up to roll dice for you. I guess you can show them a picture on occasion of what's happening. What you want the players to think about or imagine about. But then what? What does that do then?
Just draw a line up to her and say, that's Maven. Now, the reason I can do this is because I can print this out again if I need it, right? And in fact, I can even cut out the image. And then if I want to put it on a, make an NPC character out of it, okay, out of her,
next?
I can.
What's next?
I've got different names here. Maybe this.
Okay, he's got a floor plan.
This is probably one of the hardest things to get the AI to do, is to actually create a plan. So I'm going to.
Try doing Starship deck plans. That one's a toughie. At least 6 months ago it was. Now it's not. The AI can do it. In different styles, too.
I have the entrance here. The players came in here. There's a little bit of an area. Maybe you can, you know, you can put, you can leave some stuff here or whatever. And then this is the main room here. That's the main room where they are. And then there's different things. I could figure it out what it is. Maybe this is a stable. Right? Out back. Different rooms. We need a door here, so I'll just add a door. See, the AI is not going to be great, so, you know, not perfect.
But here's the thing. With most players, the 99 percenters, they're not going to care. They're not going to care about any of this. And maybe it's nice for the GM to do it as reference when they're saying, okay, now you guys are all in the tavern. Okay, now you guys are going to go around to the stable. And it's nice to have a picture for yourself, not to show them, but a picture for you, just to remind yourself where the players are. Because the players aren't going to tell you squat. They're going to say shit about what their character's doing. So you probably need, as a DM, you probably gonna need several sheets of paper like this behind your dungeon master screen. You know, checking off where the players have been, where they're going to go next. You're playing Clue. The players are rolling dice to see what room they get to move to, I suppose. And you're moving all the players for them behind the scenery.
But as long as you don't need it to be perfect, as long as you can work with it and you can use your imagination, it just works great. I love it. So,
what are you using this for, though? Like I said, 99% of the players out there don't care about this stuff. They're not interested in looking at the floor plan of a tavern. It's like, what is this for? Does it get your mindset as a GM or a DM? Does it get your mindset into the, yes, all my players are in the tavern now. I'm such a genius at this, at getting my players to do what I command them.
Here we'll have some stairs going to the upstairs, because there was an upstairs part. The upstairs part is here that they were seeing. All right. And then they were slightly under the up part. Say they were here. Okay. So we've got kitchens, we've got rooms, we've got a stable, everything. We've got all laid out what we need. Maybe these are some rooms that you can rent. And
when the off chance that a player says, is there a kitchen? Is there a bathroom? Is there like a private study area? Is there bedrooms in this place? You could say, why, yes, there is. And then the player says, okay, well, I'm going to go in the bedroom. Okay, you guys are upstairs now in the bedroom. No, not everyone, just me.
And there we go. I mean, it is absolutely good enough, and it's better than actually a lot of adventures provide. So Stu, say he's a warrior.
Okay, what's
this? Tell him while you're approaching a castle.
A castle, okay.
And here's, and you can show them a picture of the castle. And it looms over the town. It's
Yeah.
And whatever, you can fix that. So the players, they go into the castle, and now
you assume they do, you tell them they do, they're waiting for you to say that they're in the castle. Not many people go in castles, by the way, unless they're ruined castles and it's a historical treasure and everything's roped off where you can and cannot go in the castle.
You can just use your imagination, describe what they see and stuff, but if you need castle plans, here's some castle plans, and you can...
Okay, I would have run this through Photoshop a couple times just to erase some of this stuff, or make some of the stuff layered so you can add or remove the trees and stuff. This all looks like one... This is all one layer. It needs to be separated out. But then you can label stuff if you're going to use this. Once again, the players don't care about any of this shit. They don't care about any of it. They're going to sit in their chairs and say nothing during your game session. They're going to imagine all this wondrous stuff. If you show them this stuff, they'll imagine it and go, wow. But what good is player imagination if they don't share it with anybody? If they don't say what... If a player doesn't say what they're imagining during a game session, what is the point of the player being there at the table? Other than to be asked, can you... You know, what does Atlas say in Bioshock? Now, I need you... kindly now, can you roll for me? He always says kindly. May you... How does he say it exactly? I can't remember now. May you kindly make a roll for me, please? That's basically what the DM says to players all the time. Other than, what do you do?
And just, now again, the door is not laid out perfectly, and it's a little bit higgly-piggly all over the place, but again, there...
Yeah, what's the next one?
It's where they're having trouble with the goblins, and they need you to wipe them out.
Okay, yeah, mountains, you can't... I would just say mountainous area, mountainous region. That looks cool. I like doing caverns. Before I did CG, let's see, after painting and before CG, I used to do pixel painting. Using the old mouse with the one button on the mouse. With 16 color screens, and I would draw caverns like this. Kind of cool.
There's goblins inside these caves, and they often go up on the ridges and they shoot down. So this is an adventure right here. I didn't do a map of the area or anything like that. I could have. I just didn't.
But again, the players don't care about this stuff.
I put some ruins on a hill by Constable. That's it. And this is what it gave me. So nobody's being hurt. It's got wonderful Constable clouds in it, Constable mountains. Love.
No one being hurt? Hey, does the AI... the AI does action stuff. Have the AI do this, but have, like, you know, villagers getting pillaged. Lots of screaming and yelling and firing squads off to the side somewhere. That'd be kind of cool if the AI can do that. I know AIs don't do naked people. That's a no-no. And, but gunshots to the head, I don't know if the AI does that. You can do people eating guns. There's a lot of videos on YouTube of celebrities eating things like concrete and inanimate objects, drinking ketchup all day. You know, the AI can do that until the cows come home. So what's the plan here, though? I mean, I like this picture. This is a good picture. But how often are you going to show it to the players? Like, Are you going to drag the players to this place so that you can then show them the picture that you've generated with your AI? That's the thing. Like those pictures I was showing on the Pinterest, those are, I use those as artifacts. I'll have them in a folder, the manila folder thing. And I'll pull one out as they encounter something. Like here, this is the town. This is what it looks like. I leave it there. They can all pick it up and look at it and go, ooh, ah. I'm not going to use it as a map. If a player wants a map, they're going to have to make their own map. Here, have some paper. Here's a pencil. Start drawing. Draw your map of where you guys go. Some players like to do that. Some players like to do that. They like to... like a journal. Some players like to fill in a journal so they can remember what happened since the last session. Some people want to draw during the session. That's fine. I'm not going to give them Thomas Brothers' map of an area. No. No. It's like in the old days. In the old days, people would be playing Call of Cthulhu. And they try to solve the riddle using their phone. I'll just text somebody. Some people would say, oh, the cell phones, they ruin Cthulhu game sessions. Well, don't let phones in your game session.
All this painting style. I didn't put oil painting in or anything like that. Didn't really need to. Stable diffusion seemed to just... And a by constable. And it gave me this, which is really kind of neat. So I've determined what the entrance is going to be here. I'd have to go through and I'd have to label things, you know. This is the entrance, and I would just number everything. These are the, you know, what happens in this room, this room. I would determine where the doors are. And I would do all this before the game, lay out the monsters and everything. And I've got a really great dungeon. So I got all this artwork in an hour.
You could look at this map two ways. One, these are like roads, you know, paved sidewalks, and the gray areas are the structures. You know, like here's a building, and the walkways go around the buildings. Or you could look at it this way. The white area is a wall, concrete wall, 10 feet thick. And the gray part is the open area that you can walk around in. Yep. Anyway.
And it would be really awesome for a game. We'd have a blast. And plus these locations now. You know, when I pull this out, oh yeah, I know where we are, right? The players can, you can print out their own map for it. And they've got their own map of the...
Yipes. Mapville. Let's play Mapville. So they got these cool things to look at, and they're going to be saying, so are we... Okay, so where are we on the map? They're going to be saying that every single time now. Where are we at the map? We need to go where now on this map? That's the conversations you'll be having. I'm convinced that 99% of players don't roleplay. They just want to have fun and hang out with their friends and roll dice and be told how amazing their characters are if they roll decent enough.
Can have a consistent feel to it. This is, if you notice, this all feels consistent. It's because I used by.
Well, you say era. You know, I'll tell the AI in a heartbeat. I'll say, I need a flying car. Circa 1920s. I need a flying car. Circa 1930s. I need a flying car. Circa 2070s. The AI adjusts accordingly. But I'm not going to make it the main attraction in a game. It's an artifact. If the characters are near one, I'll show it to them. Here. They look like this. And they're like, okay. But it's not the focus of the game, though. They all have the image in their head now of what these things look like. They can drive around in or rent or whatever. That's it. That's all it's used for. It's not, we're not playing Star Trek the motion picture where the USS Enterprise was the star of the show. You know, we're not playing Knight Rider where Kit was the star of the show. We're not playing Chitty Chitty Bang Bang where Chitty Chitty Bang Bang was the star of the show. We're not doing that. Anyway, this video is only an hour and 20 minutes. Gosh.